study that showed that if you made $70,000 a year, people were happy. And so as CEO of his company, he decided to raise the minimum wage for all of his employees to $70,000. And that came out in the news because it was very unusual. The janitors pushing the brooms and the secretaries answering the phones, all of them received raises to $70,000. It's very unusual, and that's why it made the news. And so this week there was a follow-up article to that previous news, because people were curious as to how it was going. Well, it turns out that all the ones who received the raises are happy. Their lives have changed dramatically. However, several employees have left the company because they were unhappy that others had received such a large raise and they did not. They were already receiving more than that minimum wage. I believe they were engineers or something of that sort. They didn't get such a large raise, so they were unhappy and they left. Isn't it sad that someone can be unhappy at the good that someone else receives? In today's gospel message, we see a very similar thing. Jesus is bringing forgiveness into the life of a man, and yet you see the Pharisees and the Sadducees grumble. They're unhappy about what has happened. They see it as blasphemy. And rightly so, because in their minds, only God can forgive sins. And for Jesus to forgive this man's sin in their minds, and in interpreting the law literally, they were correct. He was committing blasphemy. Simply because they did not know who he was. Today in our world, there's a lot going on here in America and around the world where people need the grace and mercy and forgiveness of God, just like that man in today's gospel lesson. Not only was he sick of the palsy, as our gospel says, he was paralyzed, but he needed God's mercy. He needed God's forgiveness. He needed the healing power of Jesus. Course, and he received it. But more importantly, he received the forgiveness that God can bring. And just like those people who left gravity payments because they were unhappy that others had received such a large raise, there are many today who are unhappy with their lives. Just this week, the American Anglican Council sent out their weekly update, and they noted that the Episcopal Church's attendance had dropped 3.5% from one year to the next. Over 23,000 people fewer attending church than the year before. That's true of a lot of churches, not just the Episcopal Church. And then they noted that the governor of California had signed a bill authorizing assisted suicide in California. This is just a continuation of how our society is devaluing life. Everything from abortion and taking life before it even has a chance to be born, to now hastening death before the natural time of death that we might experience and expect. And what we're seeing through all of this is an increase in people who are miserable in their lives. People are thinking, well, if we have all these freedoms and we can do whatever we feel like, we'll be happy. And they're finding that they are not. And they are not happy. They are miserable. As we saw in our gospel today, they brought that man who was paralyzed to Jesus because they had heard the stories. This man can heal. He can change this man's life. He can put him back on his feet. The same is true today. People need Jesus. And they're miserable without him. I'm not getting anywhere near the sermon that I actually wrote this week. Sometimes that happens. People need Jesus. As much as that man who was paralyzed, those two engineers that left because they didn't get a raise need Jesus. The man committing murder and going to jail needs Jesus. The husband committing adultery on his wife needs Jesus. The person drinking too much alcohol, uncontrollable, needs Jesus. All the people I told the children about a little while ago, the poor, the homeless, the addicted, need Jesus. We're all in need of forgiveness. The Bible says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It doesn't say those who are not going to church have fallen, have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But all have sinned. So we're all in need of forgiveness. And I expect that most of you here know what I'm talking about. You've experienced it. I've gotten to know you, those of you who are members of this church. And so you know what I'm talking about. You come and you receive that forgiveness when we say the confession on Sunday morning. And you receive what God has for you. But there's millions of people out there who are living lives of desperate, what's the word I'm looking for? Well, they're just plain miserable. They're so desperate, they don't even know what they're looking for. They're trying to find happiness in things that only satisfy for the moment. When you and I know, the only thing that can bring real joy is the forgiveness and mercy and grace of Jesus Christ. And that's what they need. And they're not even aware of it because they're not hearing what you are hearing this morning. They're ignoring it, hoping to find it somewhere else. So just like William Booth 100 years ago, the church needs to stand up and be willing to proclaim the gospel to the ends of the earth, to pronounce that Jesus is willing to forgive, to heal, to set free, to renew lives, if you'll just turn to him. So just like those men brought their friend who was paralyzed to Jesus, you and I can do the same today. We can bring people to the cross. We can bring people to a place where they can meet Jesus. Maybe you don't feel quite ready to introduce them. Bring them here and I'll get them. I'll tell them what it's all about. Hopefully they'll hear it from the pulpit. So I want to encourage you, as you leave today and go back to your homes and your lives every day, that you stay aware of those people in your